So we got the a little bit of a
Yes. Oh, by the way, welcome to the Whiskey Vault.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Whiskey.
I'm Daniel. This is Rex.
Vault.
He's got the hair, and I've got the looks.
So this isn't just random shenanigans.
What you look like?
There's purpose. There's intentionality.
I just realized what you look like.
What do I look like?
You look like, what's the Hot Shots? Isn't that the movie where it's like a fake
pardon,
Rambo?
Dude.
Yeah, totally.
So, hey, I'm going to steal from a tribe member who I have no problem stealing with.
Okay.
I'm not going to mention his or her name because I know how much it's going to bother them.
That you didn't.
But they made a joke that I'm going to totally blatantly outright steal.
Okay.
Thought it was very funny.
Fair enough.
And this person said, wow, Rambo really let himself go.
That's a really good one.
And you get no credit.
Okay, so this is cool.
All right, we'll get into this.
Okay.
Okay. With Michter's, what did Michter's
so
something?
Michter's, remember, was the old brand.
Sour Mash.
That was a really famous brand, and then it got sort of revived, right?
Uh-huh. You can really smell the sour.
Well, here's the thing about Sour Mash. Sour mash is common in almost every single American distillery.
Okay.
All sour mash is you know how you do the fermentation run, and then when you're finished with the fermentation run, that's what you end up distilling?
Hold on. I initiate listening.
Yes.
You do the fermentation run, and then you're finished with... Yeah, okay.
Yeah. Yeah. So then you start over, and you start with the mash that you add yeast and ferment again.
Yes.
Well, this takes some of the fermented stuff, instead of distilling it, puts it back into the mash in order to help kickstart fermentation on the next batch.
Okay.
It's not actually sour.
Nope.
It's basically a way, think of it like a sourdough starter.
This is what you do. You go down to your office, you grab a handful of peanut M&Ms, you stuff them in your mouth, and come up here and smell that.
Wow. I'm sour. Not gonna do that.
Sour.
It's not, well, I should say maybe there is a sour note in here, but it's not because the word sour mash doesn't mean anything. It's actually sweet at that point.
And this the only reason they put sour on the label is because it is sour. It has nothing to do with the mashing process.
No, it's not true.
Researched.
Totally not true. However, this is not enough of a dominant grain in any direction to be called a bourbon or a rye.
I think my role should be just giving fake information.
Yeah, that we always have to
correct
later on. It's like, look. God,
and then every once in a while, I throw in something real, and you're like, wait a minute.
Dude, I'm gonna end up with someone in like the sommelier class who quotes something to me. I'm like, that was Rex.
That's not never quote.
That is
Rex.
Not true.
Never quote Rex.
No, actually, so this, in theory, it doesn't have enough grain to be either a bourbon or a rye. Enough dominant grain.
I was gonna say this just smells like a bourbon on.
So this is probably a not quite 51% corn.
Right.
Rest rye and maybe some barley would be my guess.
So on the nose, I'm not expecting to fall in love with this. I'm getting some oakiness, the sour wood. Obviously bourbon sweetness.
I'm getting a lot of fruit.
Fruit?
Yeah.
Dari, don't let me eat M&M's right before a show anymore.
Yeah, dude, you just ruined yourself.
Yeah.
No, this is a very fruity nose.
What else do we have in here? You don't have water?
We don't do water.
You don't have ice?
We don't do ice.
Remember it was like months ago.
What do you take us for?
It was months ago. I was talking about we're gonna switch up the format a little bit, just tweaks and adjustments. And I can't get a fucking foothold to even begin to make these evolutions in the show.
Because you don't care enough to implement them.
No. Look, how is ice and water my thing? Am I in charge of this?
Because you cared about it.
God,
son of a. You're in charge of it now.
I like have a whole. And then this bottle can. That doesn't even make you here most of the time. That is me. I'll claim that. Everything else I want to do is like, hey, Daniel, but no, I didn't do that.
So to me, it shows up as this dominant fruity round note at the beginning, but as you taste it. But as you drink, it sort of spreads and thins, and there's not a lot of the corn dusty note. There's not a lot of the heavy rye spice. It's like it didn't go either direction, and then it ends a little bit thin.
I get sour, bitter, oaky, sweetness.
This is
speaking of things that...
This is not my favorite Michter's.
Speaking of things that annoy me about Daniel.
Why is this that episode?
Well, hold on. Because You wouldn't know it from watching this show, but Daniel actually has some entertaining stories. And it's maddening to no end. Whenever we're like minutes from getting up here and shooting a show. And he tells me a funny story.
Like, but I don't think it belongs on the whiskey show.
What the hell are you doing?
You think that belongs on the whiskey show?
If it's a funny story, it's a funny story.
All right, I'll tell that story this morning. It's awesome.
It's a funny story. Now, I don't know if you can recreate the funniness.
Yeah.
But it was a funny story.
So today was the first day of school. And it's, you know, that's the day you want to, like, walk your kids in. Because right. You're in elementary school. By the time they're in junior high, just like, get the crap out of the car. Right? But in my elementary school, it's like, come on, children.
Mm-hmm.
It's your first day of second grade.
Right.
It's the first day of fifth grade, the last day of elementary school.
Right.
Let's all walk our children to school.
Right.
Oh, hell no. Mm-hmm. Not in my neighborhood. In my neighborhood, first day of school is like a Mad Max movie. It was like, I kid you not, I'm walking, we're driving. And by the way, the city forgot to paint all the crosswalks.
Yeah.
And so for the last 3 weeks in the forum for the student parents on the interwebs, there's just been this rage, underlying rage of the city not caring about the lives of our children because they didn't paint the white sidewalk crosswalks.
Yeah.
And how are our children ever going to know how to cross the street?
Mm-hmm.
And their lives are at risk. And so their parents, there's like one lady banged on the hood of a car because the car was like this far over what would have been a white paint stripe. Another mom jumped out of her minivan, climbed on top of a car next to it, and shouted, "Witness me!" Right. Okay, that might have been a slight exaggeration, but it was serious, man. And then the principal basically didn't do much to make it easier. In fact, she sort of...
Spreadsheets fall apart whenever humans get involved.
Yeah, she sort of just threw gasoline on the flame. It's like when you get that grease fire in the kitchen, and someone goes, "I'll help," and they throw water on it. You're like, wait!
See, that's my point. Spreadsheets, when theory crafting in the comfort of an office, they can be valuable.
Yes.
To a certain extent.
Yes.
You throw human beings at it,
and
it's worth a call.
Well, I should say yes and no.
Yes and yes.
I would say that while yes, it's easy to get blindsided by the human element when you're crafting the perfect infrastructure, a person who understands that knows that a spreadsheet can only eliminate some of the potential problems. And at a certain point, humans get involved and you have to walk away from your spreadsheet and deal with it as it is in front of you.
You just hand out enough whiskey and everything solves itself.
Yeah, that's our goal.
We got Jeffrey Kolef. I wonder if you could do dad... I wonder if you could do dad jokes on the bottle label of "do not buy" as reasons not to buy it.
Yeah, as encouragement.
But then we'd be doing dad jokes.
Yeah, but it's sort of like when you get a pack of cigarettes and it has the whole government warning.
Right.
The fact that there's dad jokes on it could be like a warning that this is not a whiskey you should drink.
Even more discouragement.
Yeah. I like that idea.
Maria M. Guys.
Oh, yeah.
That's mine. I wrote a note during class and everything.
That's right. The Kentucky.
Sigh.
She's talking about the Kentucky.
I wanted to be a magnificent bastard. That's clearly.
All right, Maria Meredith. You magnificent bastard. Far better than her significant other, the Weddle.
Oh, married to the arms. Oh, I'm so... Huh?
Not married.
Oh, no. Well, you still have a chance to get out. You're not stuck yet. Logos. I was living in London when Placebo formed. Saw them live at the 100 Club.
Yes, how cool is that?
He's like, he talks about Placebo and Elbow and like one other band.
No, I just thought that was cool.
Anytime you bring up...
No, I thought that was cool. So here's my question. What's the
Working
band?
With the photographer shot a lot of their album. Favorite song was 36 Degrees. I know it's no big deal. So good band.
Yes. So here's my question.
Just
what is there any band that you saw that's a big deal that you saw where you were like, they weren't really a big deal when I saw them?
Yeah, sure.
Who was that?
Well, okay, hold on.
I have a random super cheesy 90s one.
Okay, well, there's one bigger than this, but this is the only band I can remember. Do you remember Puddle of Mud?
Yes!
So Puddle of Mud, they were like nothing, and they were opening for a band I actually went to see. So I saw them when they were microscopic. But there's another one where they blew up to be huge. I can't remember what it was though.
I saw Jars of Clay.
Oh, I remember.
In a tiny little club in Dallas called The Door.
This is hot.
And they were doing a two acoustic and hand drums combination, and they hadn't even released their album yet that had the Flood or whatever the big song that was their radio hit. They hadn't even released that, but they were playing it in that club on acoustic guitars, opening for another band. And I went, well, that's a really cool song. That's my only one I've ever seen at that one.
I'm far enough away from the chocolate to start to taste this whiskey now.
Yeah.
And I'm still getting more sour and more bitter than I get from most bourbons, American whiskey.
So I agree with that. It's less sweet than a typical bourbon.
There's sweetness there because it's, you know, very bourbon-y, if not an actual bourbon. But,
There's kind of a bitter back end to it.
So far, my favorite Michter's is the Michter's American still.
Yeah.
Yep.
Me too. All right, here's to fighting, stealing, and drinking.
If you fight, may you fight for a friend.
If you steal, may you steal a lover's heart.
If you drink,
may you drink with us.
Hey, thanks for hanging out with us in the Whiskey Vault. Don't forget to throw on a like, hit that subscribe button on the bottom right, and drop a question or comment down below.